Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss about the series RL circuit. What is series RL circuit? Practically any inductive load you take, that inductive load will always have a resistor associated with the inductor, because pure inductor is not realizable in practice. So let us take, for example, I am taking an inductor. I am having a resistance R. It is having an internal resistance of R and it is having a inductance of L. Let us assume the voltage drop across this R is VR and the voltage drop across L is VL. I am just separating the resistance and the inductance separately to make the analysis easy. So let us assume the voltage drop because of the resistance is VR and voltage drop because of the pure inductance which I separate from that is VL, and as a result of applying the voltage V, let us assume some current I is passing. So how to represent this? We have seen in the last classes that if you are taking my current as my reference, always the current passing through the resistor will be in phase with this, or the voltage drop across the resistor will be in phase with your current, because voltage and current are in phase for the case of resistance. Now for the case of inductance, we have seen the current lags the voltage by 90 degrees, or we can tell the voltage leads the current by 90 degrees. So current drop or the voltage drop across your inductor will lead the respective current by 90 degrees. So I have drawn this. So now there are two voltages, one is VL and the second one is VR. I have to take the vector sum of these two voltages to get my resultant voltage. So resultant voltage will be this one, vector sum of these two. So this resultant voltage will be equal to supply voltage V. So this I am naming with some term Z. What is Z? We are going to calculate. Let us assume this voltage, this resultant voltage is leading your respective current by some angle phi. So now, from this parallelogram, I can calculate V is equal to square root of VR square plus VL square. So this I can write as VR is nothing but I into R. So this is IR square plus I into XL square. So this I can separate out. This will become I into square root of R square plus XL square. So this I into square root of R square plus XL square I am representing as Z, where this Z is equal to square root of R square plus XL square. This is called as the impedance of the circuit. This is called as the impedance of the circuit. And impedance also will be represented in ohms, because both are represented in ohms. So again, from the same thing, let us try to calculate tan phi from this. I can calculate my value of tan phi. Tan phi is equal to opposite by adjacent one. So what is opposite? Opposite will be equal to I into XL or VL. So VL divided by VR from this diagram. So VL is equal to I into XL and VR is equal to I into R. So I is common in both. I can separate them. This will become XL by R. Or from this I can calculate my value of phi is equal to tan inverse of XL by R. So let us try to draw the diagram for this, representing this. So there is a triangle, there is some angle phi. So tan theta is coming as opposite is coming XL, adjacent coming R. So what will be this hypotenuse? Hypotenuse will be equal to R square plus XL square. What is this value? This is nothing but equal to Z. So you can see here three impedances are coming, R, XL and Z. This is called as the impedance diagram. Impedance diagram. From this impedance diagram, I can easily calculate any parameter. So let us try to calculate the power. So to calculate the power, I need the voltage value as well as the current value. So voltage, let us take as reference. So I am taking as V maximum sin omega t. Then I is equal to I maximum sin of omega t. If you are taking voltage as a reference, you can go back to this. If you are taking this voltage as a reference, with respect to the voltage, your current is in this direction, or we can tell that current is lagging behind the voltage by some angle phi. So omega t minus phi. We can tell that current always lags the voltage by some angle in the case of inductive load. If it is pure inductive, it will be 90 degrees. If some resistor is associated with this, effectively the value of the flux phi will change. Let us take, for example, you can take from this impedance diagram. As the value of the resistance is decreasing, if this is decreasing, the XL is remaining constant, automatically it will go on shifting here. If it shifts here, automatically you can see the value of phi will go on increasing. If R is equal to 0, the XL will come here, automatically this angle will be equal to 90 degrees. That means the value of the R and XL, the ratio on R and XL will decide what is the angle between voltage and the current. So let us try to calculate the power. So we know the instantaneous power P is equal to instantaneous voltage multiplied by instantaneous current. So this I can write as V maximum sin omega t, I maximum sin omega t minus phi. So this I can separate out V maximum, I maximum. I am multiplying and dividing with 2. So this will be 2 times of sin omega t minus phi. So 2 sin A sin B will be equal to cos A minus B minus cos A plus B. So this will become cos of A minus B will become cos phi minus cos A plus B. 2 times of omega t minus phi. So this I am separating into 2 terms. V maximum I maximum by 2 into cos phi minus V maximum I maximum by 2 into cos of 2 omega t minus phi. So you can see the term, this term is a constant term which is independent of the frequency, and this term, if you see, you can see here it is having double the frequency. So the double frequency component is there, which oscillates at double the frequency. So if you want to calculate the average power will be average over one cycle. So if you take the average over one cycle, that means you have to take 1 by 2 pi integration from 0 to 2 pi this small p into d omega t. So if you substitute this, you can see here whenever you take this term is a constant term, it is not going to affect. But this term, if you take the average over 2 pi, you can just calculate it, it will become equal to 0. So only term that will remain is this V maximum. So I am just separating the 2 into 2 terms, I maximum by root 2 into cos phi. This is nothing but V into I into cos phi. So we got the average power P is equal to V into I into cos phi. So here one extra term is telling, coming as cos phi. So you can see here, to get the average power, I have to multiply my product of V into I, because in the case of DC or the resistance, we can directly take V into I is equal to power. But here one extra factor is multiplied to get my average value of the power. This factor is multiplied for getting the power. So that's why this is called as power factor. Power factor is the factor by which your V into I should be multiplied to get the actual value of the power consumed. So this is called as power factor of the circuit. So ideally I want my cos phi should be equal to 1, but practically the cos phi will not be equal to 1 because of the effect of inductance in all the practical circuits. So let us proceed further. So same thing I want to represent using the pictorial form or in graphical form. So let us take for example, this is my supply voltage. V is equal to V maximum sin omega t. So then the current we have seen, current will lag the voltage by some angle in the case of inductive load. How much it is lagging depends on what is the ratio of inductance and capacitance. Let us assume it is lagging by some angle phi. So now from this I can calculate my power. So the power will be the product of the voltage into current. So this is my value of the current, I maximum sin omega t minus phi. So this is my voltage. Okay, now calculating the power. Power is the product of these two. At this point it will be 0. Again at this point 1 is 0, so it will be 0. Here also it will be 0. Here also it will be 0. So now in any point in between, so you can see the current is negative initially and voltage is positive. So the resultant will be negative. So it is coming as negative. Then it will be positive. It will reach 0 here. Again it will be negative for this duration. Again it will be positive for this duration. So this is called as the power P, instantaneous power. So instantaneous power is having two components. One is some negative component and some positive component. You can clearly observe here, as the value of phi is increasing, the amount of the extent by which the wave goes to the negative cycle will increase. When negative cycle is increasing, then average power will decrease. Average is average of the positive value plus negative value. So if you take for half cycle, this is what is the area of this positive curve minus area of this negative curve. So as the negative curve is increasing, automatically my net power or the average power is decreasing. And you can see that when phi is equal to 0, entire power will shift to the positive side only. So my power is increasing. So I can write my power P is equal to V into I into cos phi. So this I can write because we know V is nothing but I into Z multiplied by the current I into cos phi. cos phi, from the impedance triangle, we have just drawn the impedance triangle. This is R, this is XL, and this is my Z, this is my angle phi. So cos phi you can write as adjacent by hypotenuse. So this becomes R by Z. So this ZZ will cancel. This will become I square into R. So we can tell that the actual power that is consumed is only because of the resistance, and the inductor never consumed the power. And we have seen in the previous class also the case of pure inductance. It takes the power for one quarter cycle and return is back to the supply for another quarter cycle. So average power will always be equal to zero. So let us now see what is Q factor of the coil. So you can tell this Q factor is nothing but which indicates the quality of the coil. So the quality factor of a coil is defined as the ratio of XL divided by R. Because ideally I want my XL should be equal to infinite, because any coil I design, I want it should be a pure inductor. But practically some resistance also included. So that's why it is a ratio of XL by R, or we can tell this as the ratio of omega L by R. So ideally I want my resistor should be equal to zero, so that this quality factor will be infinite. That means we can tell better the value of the Q, we can tell that better the value of the coil, that is more inductance when compared to the resistance. This is what the ideal characteristic I want. So this Q factor also can be defined in another way. So Q factor is equal to 2 pi times of maximum energy stored divided by energy dissipated per cycle. It is the energy stored by energy dissipated by cycle. Let us try to derive this. What is going to come? Is it same like before or not? So maximum energy stored, in the case of inductor, the energy stored is equal to half Li square. So half L into maximum energy means it will happen when the current is maximum. So I maximum square divided by energy dissipated. Energy dissipated will be equal to I square into R. That is the energy dissipated. Multiplied by per cycle. Per cycle means in one time period of your cycle. Or this I can write as 1 by F. So this I am further simplifying. Here this 2, 2 will cancel. This will become pi L into I maximum. I can write IRMS multiplied by root 2. So root 2 times of IRMS whole square divided by I square into R into T, I can write as 1 by F. So this I can bring to the top. So this F will become pi F L, root 2 whole square will become 2. So I am bringing it here into I square divided by I square into R. This I square will cancel. So this will become 2 pi F L. 2 pi F L is nothing but omega L divided by R. This is same thing I got. This is nothing but XL by R. So we can represent the Q factor in this form also. 2 pi into maximum energy stored by energy dissipated per cycle. So to proceed further, so let us try to solve some numericals so that this concept will be completely clear to you before we proceed to the next example. So in a circuit consisting of a resistance of 5000 ohms and then inductance of 1 Henry in series, a voltage of 150 volts at 400 hertz is applied. Determine the magnitude and phase of the current and voltage across the resistance and the inductance. Calculate the power taken from the supply. So let us see what it is given. So whenever something is given, try to note down whatever things are there. It is written there the circuit is consisting of a resistance and an inductance. So I am just drawing the circuit so that every parameter I can represent here. So the resistance value is given as 5000 ohms and the value of the inductance is given as 1 Henry. So I am just noting down whatever is given. A voltage of 150 volts. So the supply voltage is 150 volts and it is supplied at 400 Hz. Determine the magnitude and phase of the current. So they want the current I, because I can simply tell that small I is required, and voltage across the resistance and the inductance. They want voltage across the resistance and voltage across inductance. Calculate the power taken from the supply. So what is the power P? So these things are required. So let us try to calculate one by one. So first thing is I have to calculate my value of XL. XL is equal to 2 pi FL. So if you substitute it, it becomes 2 pi into frequency is 400 into inductance is 1.0. So this becomes 2513 ohms. So we got this. So we get the impedance Z is equal to square root of R square plus XL square. So if you substitute this, you will get it as 5600 ohms. So now I can calculate my current. So current is equal to V by Z. So V by Z will be equal to 150 multiplied by Z is 5600. So 0.0268 amperes. So current came, if I want to represent the current in phasor form, I need the value of phi. How can I get it? I can use the impedance triangle. We know impedance triangle R, XL and Z. This gives my angle phi. So from this I can calculate, because I know the value of XL, I know the value of R, I know the value of Z. So either I can directly calculate cos phi power factor angle, or otherwise I can calculate phi. Phi is equal to tan inverse of XL by R. So if you substitute this, you will get it as 26.7 degrees. We know it is inductive circuit, so that's why it will be lagging. So now I can calculate my value of VR. VR will be equal to I into R. Current multiplied by the resistance, you will get it as 134 volts. And the value of VL will be equal to I into XL. I into XL will be 67.35 volts. So we got the voltage across inductor, voltage across resistor. It is asked to calculate the current phasor. So current phasor means I is equal to I maximum. I maximum will be equal to root 2 times of the RMS value into sine of omega t minus phi. This is what is represented. So how to represent this? I am telling you briefly. So root 2 times of, you multiply with the current 0.0268 into sine of, this is 2 pi into frequency is 400 into t minus that whatever is phi is there, because here you are representing in terms of radians. So automatically angle also should be radians. This is 26.7. We know 180 degrees is equal to pi radians. 180 degrees is equal to pi radians. If I want some angle pi in radians, so this will be equal to pi by 180 multiplied by the angle in degrees, right? So this should be multiplied by pi by 180. So this entire thing will be in radians. Remember this. This will unnecessarily create the confusion otherwise. And whenever you are calculating also the sine of something, when it is represented in radians, you have to use a radians mode in your calculator. Otherwise answer will come wrong. If you are representing all in degrees, then you use the degrees mode. Otherwise, if you are representing all in radians, then you can represent in radians mode. You cannot combine both the things within single equation. Take care of this, because this will lead to the confusion. So now power P can be calculated as V into I into cos phi, or I can also calculate from I square into R. You can use any formula. If you calculate, you will get this value as 3.6 watts. So let us take another example to clarify further. So example 2, a current of 5 amperes flows through a non-inductive resistance in series with a choking coil when supplied at 250 volts, 50 Hz. If the voltage across the resistance is 125 volts and across the coil is 200 volts. Calculate the impedance, reactance and resistance of the coil. This is what is given. Let us see what is given, then we will proceed further. It is given that some resistance is there. So 5 amperes is passing. 5 amperes is passing through a non-inductive resistance in series with a choking coil. Choking coil will have a resistance in series with the inductance. So this is called as the choking coil. Choking coil, one supplied at 250 volts and 50 hedges is supplied. If the voltage across the resistor is 125 volts, this is given 125 volts, and across the coil is 200 volts, this is also given. So let us assume this resistance of this coil is R1 and X1. So it is asked, calculate the impedance, reactance and resistance of this coil. So we have to calculate what is the value of R1, X1 and what is the value of this impedance, so Z1. Or Z of the coil, ZC or whatever you name it. So I am trying to derive this. So this I can represent easily using the vector form. So let us try to represent with the vector form. So we know out of the input, so 125 volts is dropped across your resistor. So this is nothing but I can represent as VR. So along with VR, let us assume some voltage is dropped across the resistance, because all resistance should be combined, all inductance should be combined. So let us take this as VR1. So total voltage drop across resistor will be equal to VR plus VR1. Now the voltage drop across the inductor will be 90 degrees leading. So let us take this as VL1. So I am taking this point as OA, this point I am taking as B, and this point I am taking as C. So now if you combine this, this is only considering the choke, whatever is the choke. So across the choke, how much voltage is dropped? 200 volts. Now this is the overall voltage. This overall voltage, how much will be is given? 250 volts is given. So this angle is my power factor angle. This is my angle of my choking coil. So angle of my choking coil, I am representing by value theta. So using this, I can calculate all the things easily. So I can write from this, I can write OB square is equal to OA square plus AB square plus 2 times of OA into AB into cos theta. Getting it? So there are two things, two vectors. One is this vector, OA vector. Another vector is there, that is AB vector. OA vector is there, AB vector is there. If you want to do the vector sum of these two, vector sum will be equal to P square plus Q square plus 2PQ cos of the angle between them. Cos of the angle between OA, this is my OA, and the angle this AB, so this is my AB, because I am just keeping them at the same point. What is this angle coming? This angle will be equal to theta. So that's why I have represented theta. So you can substitute the things. 250 square is equal to 125 square plus 200 square plus 2 times of 125 into 200 into cos theta. So from this I can calculate my value of cos theta is equal to 0.1375, right? So now I can calculate my value of R1 is equal to that Z1 into cos theta. How to calculate my value of Z1? Z is equal to V by current, because we know the current passing. So we know the voltage drop across that. Voltage drop across this reactive coil is 200 and the current passing through the coil is 5 amperes multiplied by cos theta. So if you substitute this, you will get it as 5.5 ohms. In this way I can get it. So now I can get this from this value XL. XL is equal to square root of Z1 square minus R1 square. So this will become Z1 square is 40. So 40 square minus 5.5 square. If you calculate this, you will get this as 39.62. Okay, only thing is whenever any numerical is given, you should not unnecessarily get worried. You have to try to draw it in the form of pictorial form and note down all the given data, then think how can we solve it in an easier way. Only you have to apply whatever physics or other things you have studied and mathematics before for the solving of the networks. I hope it is clear up to now. If you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. And next class, we are going to see what is the active power, reactive power, apparent power, and what is the significance of the power factor in a circuit and solving some numericals. Thank you. Thank you very much.